looking at a combination, you'll see them working the flow between three people, and that's how we generally will do things. We mix it up so that there's a lot of angle changes, a lot of stability and transition and that sort of thing. So one of the things that started that whole process was this particular movement, which is I work up into an eye jab and she just puts something in the way. So it's not any specific move or anything like that. She's just like putting this up. For training, she keeps this up to a fairly steady resisting pressure where there's something that I feel I'm hitting something. So rather than overpowering me, she just kind of meets me. So meets me there so that I can pak sao. If it was overpowering, she came in like that, I would lop sao. So these are Wing Chun principles. So when I go through here again, I want to have something that's kind of neutral, maybe a little toward me, but not too much. If it's too soft, I'll usually get in on that high jab, so there's no need to go to a pak sao, because if that one's in there, it's in there. If she's giving me something that kind of holds me at bay, that's where I go to pak sao. And a pak sao is, flip you over here, if I go into here, if she's just going to hold my pressure right now, I'm going to just kind of give some, I'm leaning into her here. So we'll keep holding that. All I need is just enough to tap to get my the arm drop so that my strike gets in. That's the most I need to do. So I won't go to a point where I press all the way down like you'll see some people will do. They'll try to go like this and it's like, and then they'll put this into play and it's like, unless you are specifically trapping for a reason or wanting to get your other attacking tool out of play, or you need to make sure they don't reach for another weapon or something else, there's no need to do a pak sao beyond the ability. Like I said, if I put pressure here, this is all I need, is that little tap to get in. So it's the same thing here, is just that little movement so that my eye jab makes contact. She's going to have the pad set up so that we can do this as a drill. So I'm moving in, I go to the eye jab on step. So it's like our jab on step, eye jab on step. Pocks out because she puts something that meets me in the way, and then I go to the fist strike. So right there, eye jab, vertical fist. Now a better vertical fist is there. So if your elbow's out like this, that's not a really good vertical fist. This to this is really efficient. It keeps my line protected on this area so that if she shoots in and things like that, I can have that automatically there. If I do not have that there, if I'm going like this and then just trying to throw that punch, that makes it a little easier for her to get the shoot on me. So if I go like that, it's much better with the elbow down towards center line. That's what we're looking at. So again, all these Wing Chun principles on there. So off of this, we're just gonna go to boxing. So bam, I'm gonna fire again. Just like that, then hook, and then another strike. And then when we had the other person there, it's the rear elbow, and then it goes to boxing to the, it's a Muay Thai knee combination. So off of this though, this is the important part that a lot of people have some problem with. Again, it starts with this. Our movement back and forth to each other is a relational thing. She cannot just stay there while I'm doing this and expect this drill to be a little realistic. If I get to a point where I'm going like this, see how she adapted? She moved back a little bit. Normal people do that. You don't just stay there. You're not a rigid component here in this training environment. So when I pak sao and I go like this, she gives me a little space too, because she needs to buffer this. One, for holding the pad so that I have something realistic for where her head was, but also because realistically she wants to kind of give me some space. She doesn't like it when people are throwing fists at her face. And so then I'll go to the other strike, and then I'll throw in with a heel toe sway movement, throw in the hook on that line. So eye jab, pak sao, vertical, come back. And then we continued it with a cross. Eye jab, vertical, vertical, hook, cross, then we feed it back to an elbow. Eye jab, vertical fist. and then back once more. Then when you add your body to it, you just start working those mechanics a little bit better. So you relax with it, elbow, nice and relaxed, center line control here on this. Hook, my hook is here. My head does not go off like this on a hook. Keep it into your shoulder, shoulder is here. Typically my elbow's up. That way it helps work defense on that line. And I'm gonna fire from this, so here to here. My feet help with this. People who have a problem with hooks, make sure that you're close enough to your target. When you're looking at it from here, if I am too far away, I try to make up for that distance by going and rotating the wrist. And what happens is on a full impact, that starts jarring and puts the force into the joint. So we want to make sure that if we are going to throw a hook, I want to be in range where this sets up a nice line. I don't have to worry about the hook damaging my wrist anymore. It's rather important, and a lot of people will find will have a problem. It's because they're trying to hit and curve this wrist from far out. If you're going to do that, just do it open palm, because then it won't matter. And you can get a good strike on a palm. So relax into it. All you have to do is just these movements. There's no get that familiarity. Then we go back. Then you start adding your body to it. So my hips start getting into play. An upper torso movement. Because these can be done at angles. All of them. And you can mix it up. But a lot of that is you start changing it and adding variations, and these things matter later on because you can adapt. And then she can adapt. And this part on the elbow and going to the knee is important too. When she fires, she has to fire towards my jaw. She actually has to work trying to hit me. And as you can see, they have no problem hitting me. And but I ask, exactly, is they're doing what I'm telling you. If I ask for it and they don't give it to me, then it's a problem. So they give it to me to the jaw. That's what I have to train for. If you are throwing this, and I've watched people do this in other places, and what they'll do is they'll throw this like way over their head or way out here, or they won't even get to the partner. And it's like, why am I even bothering with that? In order to train this, and you can start really slow, you don't have to do this. I understand having a fist coming at you, a knee coming at you, a kick coming at you is scary for a lot of people. So you want to take it slow. She can throw that really, really slow, but still aim for my jaw and hit me. Go even slower. So you can train like this. So it's just like that. The inevitable is coming and you know it, and it's not so scary. And then you just increase the speed after a bit. And that's kind of important. Do that because when it gets down to it, then she's going to put in some speed. There we go. That's it. That's it. Yeah. And so on her end, she's got to keep that protection there. This is where a good belly pad would be in order. We didn't have one today. But otherwise, she puts that in there. This comes into play. Now, on my end here, I want to make sure my hip movement, I am working like this. As that's coming in, I'm going to use this line. I'm going to capture it and then insert the knee. And this is on a pull. I can do a lop sow. So if I get a outside lop sow on this, I can use that as part of the pull to yank the person off and put them into the knee. That way I don't have to do as much work. But on the other end, I want to make sure I'm not doing my knees like this. My face is in the way. Because if this misses for some reason, I want to be out here rather than, you know, having my head still here. So lean into it, get used to firing your shots. Yeah. So even just training, just like that, get used to that movement, then add your cover. There you go. Then you'll step off, change your range, things like that. So we're going from that Pak Sao entry, elbow, fist. She fires back. She's going to pull back. Now, if I'm hitting her like this, she's not going to just keep attacking me. So she does move. She does respond, does put something else in there. We give a little time because sometimes the person who is working the knees is not ready in the beginning because they haven't trained this before. So to help them out, when I fire this, yeah, when I fire my cross, she rears back a little bit. The majority of people that you watch and you fight and spar, they will telegraph how much they draw back. Just watch. Watch a lot of different fights, you're gonna see that. So it's not uncommon for somebody to do that and that be a realistic representation. Later, we trim that down so that there's very little telegraphing. For this training, so that a person who hasn't done this a lot gets used to this knee movement and something coming at them at the same time, that can be a bit of a coordination and a fright thing that they have to deal with. So get used to putting this out there, getting used to that, getting a sense of timing of when that's coming into play, and then put this in. That's good ab work on her end because she's got to contract. Her exhalations are not just because she's tired and she wants to breathe. It's to contract the abs on the knee coming in. So bam, she's exhaling as this is coming in. I want to make sure that when I do this, I'm not pulling back so far where I'll fall over. So you'll find this out a couple of different ways. If you have access to a belly pad, put it on. It's nice, firm, and it can take some good knees. You will then get a sense for that resistance. In here, if I'm working like this, and she starts putting a little bit more force that way, yeah, yeah, I tend to put more force in the knee. That helps me stabilize against their resistance. So you will discover that through this process. Because if you're really weak and she's excessive, or even not even excessive, and because you're on one post with the leg up, and if you're not well versed in balance, this becomes a problem. For a shorter person who is working against a longer person, so if I'm out here like this and I'm holding pads or I'm just giving the, yeah. So if I'm on this end and I feed this, yeah, she goes through like that. Now, I have a good long reach, but the problem is I'm bringing it from way back in Texas here from my rear on a cross. That's what happens. Gives her a little time to work this. So as that occurs, she can work it to where she's just slightly offside because she has to come in to bridge this gap from her length of legs to my reach on this high line. So she has to actually step in a little closer, and for her to help do this is sometimes just off at an angle, and that will help put it in. And that'll take care of your liver, that'll work some ribs. So you put that into play, and yeah, there you go. So that's what you want to play with. Yes, no, that's good, yeah, that's good. So any questions on that, put it in the comments below, and please thumbs up and subscribe if you haven't. Thank you.